An integrated infection control program can reduce the incidence of infection by as much as 30% and reduce healthcare costs. Infection Control Committee. An infection control committee provides a forum for multidisciplinary input and cooperation and information sharing. This committee should include wide representation from relevant programs, such as management, physicians, other healthcare workers, clinical microbiology, pharmacy, central supply, maintenance, housekeeping, training services. In an emergency, such as an outbreak, this committee must be able to meet promptly. It has the following tasks: to review and approve a yearly program of activity for surveillance and prevention, to review epidemiological surveillance data and identify areas for intervention, to assess and promote improved practice at all levels of the health facility, to ensure appropriate staff training in infection control and safety, to communicate and cooperate with other committees of the hospital.
Every tertiary care hospital should have a well-established infection control program. A committee should be established with participation from administration, clinicians, microbiologists, quality departments, procurement department, nursing and pharmacy representatives. The committee has the following tasks. This committee has to review and approve a yearly program of activities for surveillance and prevention. The committee should review epidemiological surveillance data and identify areas of intervention. It should promote improved practices at all levels of health facility to ensure appropriate staff training in infection control safety. This committee has to review risk associated with new technologies and monitor infectious risks of new devices and products prior to their approval for the use in the hospital. The committee should review and provide inputs into investigation of the epidemics, and it should communicate and cooperate with other committees of the hospital with common interests, such as pharmacy or antimicrobial stewardship committee, biosafety and health and safety committees, and blood transfusion committees. The hospital administration should provide the leadership for all activities related to infection control practices. A good administrator should listen to the needs of different departments or sections. He should take lead and initiative in the related matters, and he should assure that his subordinates feel the ownership of the infection control practices and program in the hospital. A good leadership and management makes a great difference in improving lives of patients in the hospital.
Infection control team may consist of an infection control officer or the ICO and infection control nurses, the ICN. Responsibilities of infection control officer: analyze the surveillance data, provide trends of HAI to the concerned unit, provide data regarding organisms isolated and their resistance pattern, investigate the outbreak if any, hold regular training program for healthcare workers on hospital acquired infections and biomedical waste management.
So every hospital should have an infection control committee, and infection control team work under the infection control committee. Infection control team mainly consists of infection control officer and along with the infection control nurses. The main responsibility of the infection control officer is to do the surveillance of the hospital acquired infection in the hospital. This data is collected from the hospital and it is analyzed, and feedback is given to the concerned physician so that a proper action can be taken to reduce the chances of infection in their respective wards. And besides the surveillance activity, we also have to monitor the environmental activities such as air sampling of OTs, various wards of the hospital, and monitoring of hand hygiene and standard precaution practices. Besides that, we also have to monitor the biomedical waste management in the hospital, especially the segregation part. The antibiogram is also prepared from the microbiology laboratory. It is analyzed on quarterly basis and it is dispatched to all the clinician so that the antibiotic policy can be followed up properly. In case the infection is rising in a particular ward, or if any suspicious outbreak of certain infection is noticed, immediately the step is taken and guideline is issued and recommendation is given. The infection control team visit that area and do the environmental surveillance also and take all the action to reduce the rate of infection and to control the outbreak of infection. And the most important part of the infection control officer is to provide training to all the category of healthcare worker regarding infection control practices, hand hygiene, standard precaution, biomedical waste management, and even the occupational hazard, such as post-exposure prophylaxis of HIV infection. So, activity is the responsibility of the infection control officer.
Responsibilities of infection control nurse, or the ICN. 1. Surveillance of HAI in vulnerable areas. 2. Collection of disinfectant from hospitals for in-use testing. 3. Settle plate culture in OTs. 4. Collect water samples for culture. 5. Biological indicator testing of autoclave in OTs. 6. Sterility testing of IV fluids received from store. 7. Check segregation of BMW. 8. Monitor compliance of usage of facilities by healthcare workers. 9. Raise awareness about hospital-acquired infections and biomedical waste management among healthcare workers. 10. Assist in the training program. 11. Liaison between HODs, CNOs, and ICO. 12. Train other nurses and hospital staff. 13. Check segregation at the collection site. 14. Check labeling, weigh the waste, and monitor final disposal of the waste. 15. Supervise designated staff for working of biomedical waste equipment, for example, autoclaves and incinerator. 16. Provide monthly data of waste generated. 17. Prepare waste audit. 18. Assist in training program, and 19, liaison between various departments of hospital setting and ICO.
I'm working as an infection control nurse, and as a role, our responsibility of infection control nurse is that we are doing surveillance of HAI in vulnerable areas such as nursery, gynae wing, MICU, ICU, pediatric ICU in any ward. Then we are giving settle plates every Monday to OTs. Then we are doing sterility testing of IV fluids received from the store. We are collecting water samples from various areas, that is nursery, drinking water from the kitchen, etc. Then we are doing sterility testing of blood bags, RCC, PRP from the blood bank. Then we are collecting environmental samples from the hospital, such as oxygen humidifiers, suction tubings, swabbing from weighing machine, from the baby cot. Then we assist in the training programs also, which is given to the healthcare workers, doctors and nurses. Then we are also monitoring the biomedical waste as a whole. We monitor the compliance of facilities given to the healthcare workers. We are daily monitoring the biomedical waste, which is sent from various departments of the hospital. We take daily rounds in the hospital and in the wards. And then we come back to the common collection center where the bags are received on daily basis, checked on daily basis, and then we weigh the bags, colored bags, and send to the registered company. And this is for the sharp, as how much sharp we are receiving from each of the wards and the weight of the sharp, and then the total of the biomedical waste according to the colored bags. Then the vehicle of the registered company which is coming daily. Then the time we are giving the waste, the driver who comes signs, and the one sister who's sending the waste daily. This is how we maintain the waste on daily basis and monthly.
Infection Control Manual. A nosocomial infection prevention manual compiling recommended instructions and practices for patient care is an important tool. The manual should be developed and updated by the infection control team with review and approval by the committee. It must be made readily available for patient care staff and updated in a timely fashion. Role of the physician. By providing direct patient care using practices which minimize infection, by following appropriate practice of hygiene, for example, hand washing, isolation, serving the infection control team for supporting the infection control team.
Once the patient enters the hospital, the first encounter is with the doctor, and the doctor can play a very important role because the doctor knows that any person who is having an infection, how to prevent this infection spreading to other patients who are not having that infection. So at that level, probably segregating those patients who are having active infection and potentially transferable to others is one of the steps. Then using a hand wash practice is also very important for the cross infection to other patients from the physician and the other healthcare providers. Then it is also very important to take care of the surroundings and the infrastructures, which can be a potential source of infection, and we need to routinely maintain the cleanliness and hygiene in those areas. Especially the infection can be a potential source, washrooms, toilets, laboratories and other areas where the infective material. Then it is also very important to formulate the policies for infection control and educating the public as well as the doctors, nurses and paramedics, so that they may be aware and they can help in preventing infection to themselves and to other patients.
Specifically, physicians are responsible for notifying cases of hospital-acquired infection to the team as well as the admission of infected patients, complying with the recommendations of the Antimicrobial Stewardship Committee regarding the use of antibiotics, advising patients, visitors and staff on techniques to prevent the transmission of infection.
We should keep some very basic points when we start antibiotics. Number one, we should be very sure when we actually are starting an antibiotic, whether we really need to start an antibiotic. So if we start antibiotics early in these patients, we are actually promoting resistance, because whatever is the normal flora or normal bacteria inside our body, they also get damaged. Number two, we should also be careful that when we start any antibiotic, we should take it to the total course of the antibiotic. If we just take it for about a couple of days or 3 days, or some people in our country, we have this fact, or since ages, it is not a wrong thing, but we just have a feeling that yes, we take one dose of antibiotic and yes, we become okay, we should omit it. So that is a wrong policy. Once we start taking it, we should complete the whole course, because one or two doses or taking it for a couple of days only, it actually promotes antimicrobial resistance. In hospitals, we should always get culture sensitivity reports and take action upon those culture sensitivity reports. It is very important that once we have the culture sensitivity report, we should actually use these reports at hand and we should use it to our benefit and to aid the judgment whether or not we should continue these antibiotics and how best to take the antibiotic use forward. The other thing is, at times once we see the reports rising, the TLC rising, total leukocyte count rising or something like that, or the fever not responding in the first couple of days, the patients panic and the doctors also, they change the antibiotic very soon. So this is another thing which I would say, that we should not change the antibiotic very soon. So if we change the antibiotic before the minimum inhibitory concentration is achieved or the drug has its levels in the body, then we are again promoting antimicrobial resistance. That we should all be more aware about the rational use of antibiotics, the antimicrobial stewardship program which is ongoing in most of the centers and as a pilot project in many of the districts. I think that is a very good step and we should all be very judicious and wise.
Role of the microbiologist. The microbiologist is responsible for handling patient and staff specimens to maximize the likelihood of a microbiological diagnosis, developing guidelines for appropriate collection, transport, and handling of specimens, ensuring safe laboratory practice to prevent infections in staff, performing antimicrobial susceptibility testing following internationally recognized methods, and providing summary reports of prevalence of resistance.
As a microbiologist, we have a big role to play in infection control. Like mainly we have to know the optimal sampling procedures for the patients, what are the right samples, how they should be collected, so that we get maximal positivity in our samples, so that we know which organisms are causing infection. Then also we need to maintain safe practices in our laboratories, sterilization, disinfection, everything should be in order. Our technicians, our people who are working on the samples should know how to protect themselves and work in aseptic environments so that we do not get infected and we do not pass on any infection or contamination to the patient samples. So once the samples come, we process them, we culture them, we do their antibiotic sampling, antibiotic sensitivity testing according to international procedures. And this antibiotic sensitivity, then we collate together and we periodically we give this report to the clinicians and for the patients so that we know which are the trends which are going on, which antibiotics are coming resistant, which are the ones which are positive and all. And over the period of time, we also, since we keep on getting a lot of samples, we know which organisms are coming. And then we can have certain organisms are coming in clusters or they're coming in abundance. So then we can, you know, kind of type, do epidemiological typing and know from where they are coming, from where the organism could have arisen, from the patient or the source, and then try to control that also. So microbiologist's role is very important to be able to, you know, diagnose the infection, to curtail the infection, and also to predict any further from where the infection could arise and stop the cycle wherever possible.
The summary. Healthcare-associated infections, also known as hospital-acquired infections or nosocomial infections, are those infections that were neither present nor incubating at the time when the patient was admitted to the healthcare facility. The majority of HAI become evident 48 hours or more following admission. It also includes occupational infections acquired by staff. Simple infection control measures can save lives of patients and staff. All healthcare facilities should establish their own infection control program. Microbiologists play a key role in infection control activities. Let's join hands and do our best to prevent HAI, because human life is priceless.